morning. Let's all stand for our call to worship. Page 2, Holy, Holy, Holy.
You may be seated. You may be seated. We are so glad that you have chosen to come and worship today. As you notice, Terry is not up front. He is not feeling well and has stayed home at the request of Waquita and the threats of Waquita, I believe, because he did not do a good job of that this week. And so he is at home resting. So be in prayer for him as he tries to do what he's supposed to do. And I don't know if you know this, but he is a little stubborn. And so well, I'm going to have to. Or you're dismissed, one of the two. Those are your options. So let's pray. And just a real quick update, Bonnie Kuhn is at McCrite Living Center and will be there for 2 weeks, I believe, at least for physical therapy and rehabilitation. Those of you who don't know, she fell at the doctor, broke her pelvis, and it's inoperable, so they can't do anything other than physical therapy. So be praying for her. We have many, many others within the church who covet your prayers, and we'll be having procedures and looking for tests and test results. Is this not on? Do I have to start all over? Okay. You are dismissed. Okay. Did you hear what I said about Terry? That he, okay. And Bonnie is in McCrite Center. She fell, broke her pelvis. There's nothing they can do other than rehabilitation, and she'll be there for at least 2 weeks. So be praying for them. Pray for others within our church who are awaiting testing and procedures and things of that nature. And so let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we're going to continue to worship this morning. I'm getting direction from the back from my wife. So, Father, we are so grateful for your goodness, for the love that you pour out over us, the mercy that you provide for us. And this morning, as we come here together, we are mindful of those who are unable to be with us. We lift up Terry, we lift up Bonnie, we lift up so many others who have not been mentioned this morning, Father, that are unable to be here, that want to be here. Father, we pray that you would give them comfort, give them rest, give them peace and healing. Father, that you would give them patience during this time. We know that so many are waiting to get in to see doctors or do testing or be ready for some type of treatment. And Father, we know that it isn't always fast. Very seldom is. And we pray that you would not only give them patience, that you would give them comfort and counsel during these times. As we continue to worship you this morning, may you be glorified. May the words that are spoken here today be your words. May they resonate within our hearts and our minds that we might understand who you desire for us to be. Father, we love you and we praise you and we ask these things in your name. Amen.
Our next hymn, Glorious Is Thy Name, we'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4. It's page 204. Next hymn is page 217. Again, we'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh,
everybody. This song is called Deliverance. It's one that, so for those of you that don't know the youth, we recently took a trip to Centennial, Wyoming, and did some work at a camp called Table in the Wilderness. I went as one of the sponsors and as music, and this is one of the songs that I introduced. There are words. They're a bit fast. Don't worry about it. It's a fun song. I like it. Your love is a flood, and I drink deep when the tide is up. Oh, would you flood me too? Salt water in my blood has made me taste sweet to the world. Oh, and you taste sweet too. This is my deliverance, hands held high as you deliver it. Oh, you have made me a child of God, my feet on the ground, my heart in heaven. I am bread made without the leaven. Oh, you have made me a child of God. I lay in the sand with sweet forgiveness in my hands. Oh, as a gift from you. Your love floods my brain. This gray cranium won't be the same. Oh, where I've been won't do. 'Cause this is my deliverance, hands held high as you deliver it. Oh, you have made me a child of God. My feet on the ground, my heart in heaven. I am bread made without the leaven. Oh, you have made me a child of God. Oh, you have made me a child of God. Oh, you have made me a child of God, and I won't go until this is my deliverance, hands held high as you deliver it. Oh, you have made me a child of God, my feet on the ground, my heart in heaven. I am bread made without the leaven. Oh, you have made me a child of God. God, we come to you right now, and we thank you for delivering us from everything in this world that's evil and goes against you. Father, you are here for us, and you deliver us, and we love you, and we thank you so much. In Jesus' name.
I'm getting perplexed looks from around everywhere. Can you hear me now? A little louder? Yeah, it is. Testing one. There we go. There it comes. All right. All right. Didn't think it was going to be that easy, did you? I will say the Mattinglys will be at least one out of two today. Jackson did a great job. Do not expect that me to do as well. Just a quick kind of let you know where we are. Went to a ball game yesterday with some youth pastor friends, and we get there and we're watching the game, and evidently Terry tried to call me while I was there, and I saw that he had called, but there was no message, and so I thought he was just calling to talk to me about OU baseball because we were taking a beating and we were going to commiserate together. And so I finished the game, went home, did stuff, and about the time the storm started blowing in, I get my phone to kind of check things, and I notice a voicemail has popped up on my phone. Well, at 12:30, I check it, and it's Terry saying, "I will not be there tomorrow. You need to preach." You want to talk about a sleepless night? So he said, "I left you a message or a sermon if you want to use it." I read it in a great sermon, but it had a lot of personal information in it. And I thought, either I'm going to have to replace that, and that means I'm going to have to think about my past and things that I did in vacation Bible school, or I'm going to have to talk like I'm Terry and share those stories. And I'm not near as old as he is, so that wouldn't make any sense. I hope he's not watching right now. So this morning I woke up, came in, and read his sermon, and just felt like God was calling us to this morning. And this is some scripture that I've been reading for the last couple of weeks, and I've just been going back and forth over it and just really trying to study it and apply it to my life and see what God has to do with it. So if you have your Bibles, I'm going to invite you to open up to Romans chapter 12. And Paul has written this letter to the church in Rome. He has written it because of an affection for not only the church, but seeing what is happening in Rome and understanding the opportunities that are taking place there. And he's not visited the church in Rome. He has not been there. He has no connection with them. But he hopes to go and be a part of that and see what is happening and connect with them in a way that he has with the other churches that he began and has supported. Well, he's close in region and is thinking he might go there, but the churches have given to the poverty-stricken in Jerusalem. They have given graciously for Paul to take back, and Paul feels like, "I need to take this back to Jerusalem to make sure that this money gets to the poverty-stricken within the church." And so he doesn't take that opportunity, so he writes this letter, and he basically is providing them with sound theology. He is sending them this information of how to live their lives, how to follow Christ, how to share the gospel, what all of that means. And we notice there's not a lot of correction in this book, in this letter, as there is in some of the other letters that he's written to the churches that he has founded or that he has this connection with. And the reason is because he doesn't have a connection with the church in Rome. And it would be very presumptuous of him to write them and say, "Hey, you're doing things wrong." That probably wouldn't go over well, probably wouldn't be a good start to a relationship if you started off with your first thing that you tell them is, "Hey, you're doing it wrong," if you don't know them. So he writes this and he shares with them, and we're going to pick this up in chapter 12, and we're going to read through verse 13, I believe. Yes, verse 13. I would like to read through 21, but we want to keep this to where we can get out on time and make Terry understand that we can do this shorter. Okay? No, I'm just teasing. I'll probably go longer than he does. Paul writes, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, Do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the measure of faith God has given you. Just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man or woman's gift is prophesying, let him use it to prophesy in proportion with their faith. If it is serving, let them serve. If it is teaching, let them teach. If it is encouraging, let them encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let them give generously. If it is leadership, let them govern diligently. If it is showing mercy, let them do it cheerfully. Then he continues on and says, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Now he writes this to the church and he is giving them some formal information to say, listen, this is some things that you need to understand that we've seen in other churches that have probably arisen and may have arisen in your church now. So let's kind of cover this and let's live our lives as the church should live our lives. And the first thing he tells them is that we should be living sacrifices. We should be a living sacrifice. And in the context of this, in the day that they're living, they understand what a sacrifice means. They understand that something is brought to the Lord or brought to a pagan god, whatever the situation is, and they bring it and they kill it and they give it. But Paul says, don't be just a sacrifice, be a living sacrifice, one that does good, one that continues on. Because we are of no use or no good or no purpose if we have no life. And so he's saying, listen, we need to live our lives as sacrifices to God. We are not to just give up everything. We're to give up everything and do everything that he asks us to do. Well, why do we need to do that? Why should we be living sacrifices? The first thing Paul tells us is because of God's great mercy. The mercy that he pours over us. He says, listen, without God, you would be doomed. Without God, you would be nothing. Without God, what does it matter? So you need to understand, he says, that to serve him, to show him your appreciation for the mercy that he has poured out over you, is that you need to be a living sacrifice. Why else should we be living sacrifices? Not just because of the mercy that he's poured over us, but because of what Paul tells us. He says, listen, this is your spiritual act of worship. If someone were to come up to you on the street and they know you go to church and they said, hey, could you define worship for me? I just want you to think in your mind, what would you tell them worship is? We tend to think that worship is we come to church, we sit in a pew, we sing some songs, we hear a sermon, we go home, and we've worshiped. That is a type of worshiping, but that is not what true worship means. What Paul tells us is that true worship is when we live our lives in complete control from God. When we live our lives for God in a manner that shows others who God is in our life and what he can be in their lives. Pastor Rick Warren at Saddleback Church, he wrote a book, The Five Purposes. And in those five purposes, there is outreach, ministry, discipleship, fellowship, and worship. And I went to a conference in 1998, right after I came, went to a conference out there and learned some things, and we adopted that, and we wrote up our own mission statement for our student ministry. And in the end of that, rather than worship, we used the word celebrate God through the living of our lives. Because I think that's what worship is. When we celebrate God with the way we live our lives, That's how we worship God. We don't just come, sit in a pew, sing a song, pray, listen, go home. We live our lives as a sacrifice to Him. In verse 2, he says, well, how do we become a living sacrifice? Here's what Paul tells us. He says, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Do you notice that he says mind? He doesn't say heart. He doesn't say soul. He doesn't say strength. He says by the renewing of your mind. Excuse me. And why does he say that? Because our mind is what helps us understand. Our mind is what holds knowledge. Our mind is what helps us learn and grow. Now, the heart gives us a passion, but the mind gives us that knowledge and the understanding of what we should do and how we should do it. Now, he says, if you do this, you will be different. My question is, do we markedly look different as believers in Christ, as followers of Christ? Do we look different than the rest of the world? The way that we act, whether it be at home or at work or in social events, does it look different than what the rest of the world is doing? Are we conforming to the world and doing what the world does, or are we being transformed and being a light, a beacon in a place that needs to see what truth really is? Now he says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. This is a process. This is something that takes time. And I know I'm preaching to the choir here. You all know that, but I think too many Christians come into, or too many non-Christians come and they accept Christ and they have this perception that it's going to be this bang. I know what to do now. God has filled me and now I'm ready to go and I won't do wrong. And when they do mess up, they're discouraged and they're disgruntled and they don't know how to handle it. And they look up and they're like, what has happened? And we've got to help them understand that this is a process. In our Wednesday conversations, and those of you that come to that, you know that both Terry and I like to talk a lot. And I know, that's surprising. But those are times that are so meaningful to me. It is such an enjoyable, collaborative learning situation that helps me define some things, helps me translate some things, helps me understand from other people's perspectives of how I should live my life and what that looks like to other people. And one of the things I have mentioned, I think, this past Wednesday, and I mentioned to some guys yesterday that I was talking to at the ball game, is that we have got to learn to be proactive rather than reactive. Too often, the church becomes reactive and tends to think that they don't know what has happened and why it's happened. We tend to wait until the situation has gotten bad enough before we go, oh, I better get this right, instead of saying, I'm going to try to get this right so the bad thing doesn't happen. And that's not just young Christians, that's all of us. And we've got to learn to be proactive in our growth, in our faith, in everything that we do for God. Now he goes on and he says, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, then you will be able to know what God's will is. How many of you, by a show of hands, would really like to know what God's will for your life is? Not everyone? Wow. Okay. It's up to you. That's okay. But here's the thing. When we say we want to know God's will for our life, most of the time we're saying, I want to know what God wants for me. I want to know what God wants for me. But we've got to understand that God's will for our life is just not what God wants for us, but what God wants from us. God wants from us obedience, to obey His commands, to do the work that He has given us.
And he gets into that here in a minute. But why should we want to conform or transform our minds? So that we can know his will. And he uses three adjectives about God's will here. He says good, pleasing, and perfect. God's good will is what creates in us a change, a growth, a process that makes us better morally, that makes us better spiritually. It gives us growth. That's what God's good will is for us to be good and to be better. God's pleasing will, here's a tough one, is to please God, not necessarily us. God's will is to please him, not what we want. And that's where we get into some sticky situations, because we're like, God, that's not my will. He's like, yeah, I know. It's mine, and it's perfect. God's will, it says it is his perfect will. His will cannot be improved upon. We cannot do anything or say anything or create anything that is better than the will that he has for us and wants from us. And if we can begin to get that into our minds by transforming our minds and understanding that who God is the best thing, then we can begin to live our lives and understand the will that he wants for us and from us. He gets into verses 3. He starts in verse 3 and he's talking about for the grace given me, I say to every one of you, don't think of yourself more highly than you ought. I think sometimes in the church, we get really caught up in judging others by what they do or don't do in the church. We hear the I've done my time thing. It's their turn thing. And I understand that from a logical standpoint, but I'm not sure I understand it from a heart standpoint. Because I don't read anywhere in Scripture where God says, you do it for this long and then you're golden. You're good. He says, I've given you gifts. I've given you a gift, and if that gift is what I've given you, then you need to use it in a manner that glorifies me and that promotes the gospel, that helps the church. Because he says, we are all one body, many parts, but we what? Belong to each other. And I think sometimes we like to look and say, well, that person's not, they haven't done anything. They haven't taught. I don't ever see them teaching. Well, what if their gift was not teaching? What if God didn't gift them to teach? Why would we want somebody who has a gift for hospitality to be wasting their time teaching? God has gifted them with something else, and we need them to be productive in that area. And so we have to understand that just because my gift is teaching, that doesn't mean that somebody over here's gift is teaching that they should be able to fill in for me because I've done my time. It means that God has gifted me, and if he wants me to do that, then I need to be that living sacrifice and step into that class and do the will of God, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. And I understand we get tired and we struggle and we're just, oh man. But I want to talk about some of that real quick. He lists these gifts off and he says that what needs to happen is that we need to all use our gifts. We need to all use our gifts. We've all heard some preacher use the analogy of the body, and if one part is gone, you're not as effective. That's what it's like. When someone's not using their gift, the body is broken. The body is not fully functioning. And he says prophecies, as if you can, if your gift is prophecy, then prophesy. Or speak the word, speak the truth, is what that means in prophecy, is to speak the truth, whether that is preaching or teaching. But prophesy the truth. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is encouraging, then encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, then contribute generously. And just a little side note. Don't say, oh, I don't have the gift of giving, so I can stop giving. That's not how it works. We are all to give. Some are given the gift of generosity. And that means not necessarily monetarily, but of time, of talent, of compassion. If it's leadership, then lead. If it's mercy, then show mercy. And he says in those last three, he gives adverbs to them. He says, if it's serving, let it serve. Teaching, teach. Encourage, let them encourage. Contributing to the needs of others, give generously. If it's leadership, govern diligently. And if it's mercy or hospitality, let them do it cheerfully. And I think there are times when we get into these places in ministry and we're serving and we don't do it cheerfully. We don't do it diligently. We don't do it generously. We do it with holding something back. And if our ministries begin to become chores rather than a pleasure or a delight, then we need to check our hearts and we need to say, God, what is it that's going on? Help me have that passion. Help me desire to serve you in the ministry, in the gifts that you've given me so that I can live in your will. The nominating committee is in the middle of putting together the 2022-2023 church year, filling places. And I'm not trying to guilt you, but I do want to just say this. There are one of two things. Either the leadership in the church has not understood what God wants in the ministries, in the positions, in the things that we have established in our Sunday school and other areas. Either we have not put that together correctly and followed God because places are not being filled, or we're following God and people are not doing the job, taking the position. And I say that because God would not lead us to have these certain things and then say, oh, by the way, I'm not going to give you any help. I'm not going to put people in there. You're just going to have empty spots. If that is what God has called us to do, then he will provide the people, and those people are within this church. And we need to step forward and we need to do the job that God has gifted us to do. If it's the other way, then Terry, myself, the church council, we need to focus in and be praying harder and understanding maybe this isn't the right ministry. But that's where your prayer and your time and your effort comes into play to understand, am I a part of the cog that runs this ship, runs this machine? In verse 9, he says, and I want you to pay attention to this. Verse 9, love must be sincere. Do you find it strange that Paul feels the need to tell the church that they need to love sincerely? Shouldn't that be a given? Shouldn't the church be a place where love is sincere? Where you walk in and you feel that and you're like, this is what it's like. This is so warm and fuzzy. But Paul understands that we are human and we will make mistakes and we get caught up in things. And he says, listen, you have to love each other. Love has got to be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. And we live in an evil, evil world. We all know that. We talk about it all the time. We see it on the TV and in the news. Everywhere we go, we see something that is evil and we think, what is going on? We have got to love more. We have got to set an example that says, listen, there's something more to this than just our humanity. And it's our God. My question when he says, hate what is evil, cling to what is good, it goes back to that question I asked earlier. Do we as followers of Christ hate evil? And a good way to tell that is, again, do our lives look different than those who are non-followers of Christ? Do we live differently? Are our habits different? Are our methods different? Is the way we love different? And that's something that only each of us can ask and answer individually to ourselves. But it starts with me. It starts with you as an individual for the church to become healthy and to grow and to do the things that it needs to do. In verse 10, he says, be devoted to one another. He doesn't say not to those that you're closest to or the ones that are devoted to you. And I will be honest, I've been guilty of that. I've been guilty of being devoted to some people more than others. And I'm sorry for that. That is the sin in us. And that's something why I'm reading this passage over and over and over, so that I can get into my mind and I can renew my mind that I need to be different. I need to do things differently. But he says, even those that you barely know, be devoted to them. And that's a risky thing, isn't it? Because we don't know them, we can't trust them, we can't, but they're in the church. We've got to be devoted to the people as a whole. And I'll share a quick story with you. Back, it's been 15 years at least, when we started two worship services. We felt the need to do it, and we heard people saying, you know what, it's going to divide us. We're not going to know each other. We're not going to be able to connect. And we heard that, and Terry and I sat down, and we talked, and we thought, and we tried to figure out, okay, what can we do? And we came up with an idea that on the fifth Sundays, we would have a breakfast during Sunday school. And so that first breakfast, I sat down, and I got tables set up, I made charts, I got different colored papers, and I got lists of people's names and what service they went to, and I sat down and I made a seating chart, so when somebody came in, I would give them a green card, you go to that green table, and you'll sit with, you know, three people from the early service and three people from the second service. This is what people did. Take their green card, drop it in the trash, and go to the red table. Why? Because that's where the people they knew were sitting. Both services. That's what people did. But we talk about we want to know each other. We want to do these things. We want to, but we don't want to be devoted to everyone. We want to be devoted to ourselves and ours. And we have to be devoted to the church. Be devoted to one another. Take care of one another. Help one another. And I'm not saying that we don't do that, because this church is so good at it. But we all have room for improvement, myself included. We all have room for improvement to be devoted to one another and to love each other and to become this unity of a church that looks different in the world. Now, verse 11. He says, never be lacking in zeal. Keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. When was the last time that you were really, really enthusiastic about God? I mean, you were just, it was just welling up out of you. That you were so excited that you just couldn't hold it in. That you couldn't stand not to tell somebody, or at least speak to somebody and say, you know what? Somebody cares about you. It doesn't have to be a beat them over the head type of a thing with your Bible. It just has to be a, hey, I care. And I want to build a relationship with you. And I want to see you know who God is. When was the last time that you were so enthusiastic that you just couldn't hold it in? And then he says, and live with fervor. Where is your passion? Do you have a passion to serve God? Do we have a passion to do what it takes to step outside these walls, to these houses, to these stores, to these schools, and say, you know what? God loves you. God cares. We have to have some enthusiasm. We have to have some passion. I think I used in the first service the word sad sacks. That we just kind of walk around like sad sacks. You know, I've got to get up and go to church today. I've got to go do this ministry thing. We should be excited. We should have a joy just spilling out of us that we get to be a part of what God is doing. He doesn't need us. He wants us. Have you ever thought about that? That God doesn't need you and me. He wants you and me. And that should just ring volumes within our minds to say, you know what? You want me? You want me to be a part of this? God, you know who I am, right? You've seen me. And you still want me? He goes on into verse 12. He says, be joyful in hope. Folks, if we cannot be joyful over the grace that God has given us, there's no hope for joy. There is no hope for joy if we cannot be joyful about the grace and the mercy that He has given us. When was the last time you were truly joyful for what God did you, for you? I hope it was today. I hope it was this morning that you got up, you maybe did a devotion and you read and you were like, God, thank you so much. Thank you. And it just welled out of you. But too often we just go about our business and we do our own thing and we miss out on the joy that He has provided. The things that He wants for us, we miss out. He tells us to be patient in affliction. In John chapter 16, verse 33, I believe, he says, in this world you will have trouble. He's speaking to the disciples, bless you. He's speaking to the disciples and he says, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I've overcome the world. That is great news. The bad news is we're going to have trouble, and we all know that because we've all been there or had some. I've been there. You may have had some. But he says, I have taken care of it. Doesn't mean it's going to be easy. Doesn't mean that everything is wonderful, but I am going to take care of it for you. So be patient. Let me walk alongside you in this. There's many of you that you're going through things right now that you're just like, God, why? And we can't answer that. But what we can is take some heart in that Jesus knew that you were going to have trouble. And he tells you, I've got it all handled. I know it's not fun. I know it's not easy. But I've got it handled. He says, be faithful in prayer. This is something that I have been really trying to make a spiritual discipline for myself. And in 1 Thessalonians 5:17, it says, pray without ceasing. And we hear that and we think, man, that's crazy. But what he's saying is communally connect with God. Continuously connect with Him. And I've been trying to have a running dialogue in my head, no matter what I'm doing, to be thinking, okay, God, what would you be saying to me and what can I say to you? How do you want me to live my life? What do you want me to do? And I have this in my heart and I find myself, when I'm doing something else, losing focus on what I'm doing over here because my mind is focused on God. And it's been something that has been invigorating has been life-changing, has been a course of struggle. But as I do that, I understand what Paul is saying when he says, be faithful in prayer, because we have prayer warriors in this church, and thank you for those people that are prayer warriors, because you are amazing and it means so much. But we all need to be connecting and communing with God. Verse 13, he says, practice hospitality. Take care of each other. Help each other out. Be welcoming. And I have to say, I don't think I've ever been to a more welcoming church than Linden Baptist Church. I've been to some, and I've heard other people talk about it, that I've gone to churches and nobody spoke to me. We had to go up to them. Practice hospitality. Continue to do that. That is a huge ministry. The last thing I want to say, actually two things I want to say, sorry. Yeah, I know. Changed my mind. In verses 14 through 20, it can be summed up in verses 17 and 18, where he says, basically, do what is right in the eyes of everyone. Do what you should do. Be moral. And then live at peace with everyone. Live at peace, if at all possible, live at peace with everyone. Meaning love them, take care of them, help them. But then verse 21, he closes this with this. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. He closes this whole chapter, this part of his letter, this little paragraph, with do not be overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. And I said earlier, we live in a world that is evil. And it's very easy to be overcome by that, for it to not only just depress you, but to indwell in you, because you get so frustrated and so angry, and you see the injustice, and you're like, I can't stand that. But Paul says, overcome evil by doing good, by taking care, by changing the way that you live your life. And how do we do that? My answer to you is this. You go back to verses 1 and 2 of this chapter. To overcome evil with good, we offer up our bodies as living sacrifices because of the mercy and the grace that he's poured over us. Because that is our spiritual act of worship. And then we don't conform to this world. We become transformed by the renewing of our minds, by reading our scripture, by spending time connecting with other Christians, by discussions, by prayer. And then we can test and approve God's will. His good, his pleasing, and his perfect will. And we can be more of what the church is supposed to look like each and every day. Making a difference, not only on the inside of these walls, but on the outside of these walls. My challenge for us today is, are we willing to just kind of remain where we are, consider worship a one-day event, or do we want to truly worship God by the way we live, so that we can understand the will that he has for us and that he wants from us. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for the words that you've given us, that Paul has written, that we can look through this, that we can understand the implications of what it means to either follow you or not follow you, to serve the world or to serve you. Father, that we would become living sacrifices. That we would worship you by the way we live. That the things that we do, the things that we say, that they would glorify you. That the things that we do and the things that we say would be seen as good works, as Jesus says in Matthew 5 that they might see your good works and glorify the Father in heaven so that they might know who he is. Father, help us. Help us to identify the gifts that you've given us. Help us to understand the commands that you've put upon us to use those gifts to the betterment of the church and for you. And Father, help us to love one another, to love those outside of these walls, and to love you more each and every day. Father, if there's someone here today who needs to accept you as their personal Lord and Savior, who they've never done that, if they just want to ask questions, Father, I just pray that you would give them the courage and give them the faith to do that today. Father, if there are those who are following you and they want to deepen their faith and they want to come closer to you, that they might come and pray, they might just where they are or at the altar, just have a desire to know you more. Father, if there's anyone here that desires to become a part of this membership, we welcome them with open arms. And we'll be devoted to them and we will care for them. That they might grow in their faith and do ministry alongside us, that you would be glorified and made famous. Father, we ask these things in your Son's precious and holy name. Amen. This morning, I hope that God has spoken to you. If there's a decision to be made, I'll be up front. I'm going to invite Karen to come, David to lead us in our hymn of response, hymn of invitation. Hymn number 238, Breathe on Me, if you would stand and sing with us and allow God to speak to you this morning. once again, thank you for being here today, for listening. I hope that God has shared with you something and has given you an opportunity to see what we can be as individuals and what we can be as a church. Continue to pray for Terry, for Bonnie, for others. Tonight, VBS starts 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock. I believe they would like for leaders to be here around 5:30, 5:35, just to be ready because kids will start showing up early. And we do have church council meeting tonight at 5 o'clock. And we will still have that if Terry is well enough that I can call him and get him on the line. We'll do that. If not, we'll just carry business and get out really fast. And so I didn't say that, did I? But I want you to go out and have a great week. If you are working Vacation Bible School, I want to say thank you in advance because it is a huge, huge ministry, and it is an opportunity for us to impress upon children and their parents that God loves them and that we love them. So as we dismiss today, go out, have a great week, and I'm going to ask Mr. David King, would you dismiss us in prayer, please, sir?